All right. Hey, everyone. Welcome to the first workshop of day two of the BEAMathon. This is how to study for exams and manage time and stress with Matthew Espinoza. And we're really excited to have him here just to speak on this topic and give you guys some amazing tips. But before we jump into that, what I'm going to do is introduce our first, prize opportunity. So if you want to have a chance to win Beam merchandise, you can go on Instagram. So make sure to follow Beam Commuter on Instagram. And at any point within this workshop, what you can do is post an Instagram story. Let's just say you want to take a picture of it, or you want to take a selfie and say, hey, I'm at this workshop about how to manage time and stress and how to study. And just feel free to go for it and tag Beam Community. Like, there's a couple times where some people auto won because there's only one person who entered. So just go for it and you might have a chance to win some sticker packs and awesome merchandise like this and some Sticker Giant sticker sheets. So yeah, without further ado, I'm just going to let Matthew share his screen, and I'm going to stop sharing here and just enable screen sharing. And yeah, feel free to take the wheel on your presentation.
Okay, awesome. Before we get started, a huge thank you to Skylar for having me on this presentation to kind of talk about studying exams, actually managing time and stress. I remember when I actually first joined this Slack community just for this event, it was crazy. Like, the amount of people doing the intros and saying hellos, the socials, you really have built something amazing over here in the Slack page. And so because of that, I do have a kind of an interesting request. And if it's possible to kind of do it throughout the entire presentation, is that I'd love to be able to have your camera on if you're comfortable with it. I'd love to be able to see your expression as I'm talking about these topics. I want to see which ideas resonate with you, because I can guarantee you there's some ideas you've never heard of before. These are things you can't find in textbooks. These are only things that I've been able to discover with working one-on-one with experts, as well as hundreds and hundreds of students across America and Canada, to be able to adapt a system that works perfectly depending on how you learn, depending on how you do these different things. So if you have a chance, I'd love for your camera to be on. I see a lot of interesting faces. Hello, guys. It's great to be able to see you guys. So let's get right into the workshop here. Okay, so a little bit about what I've done, who I am. So I've been able to work with some of the best minds in the world, including memory champions, study experts, and brain coaches, to be able to cover one secret. And that one secret is, how do you learn as quickly as possible? How do you get the highest marks without being burnt out? Which is exactly what I'm going to be talking about in this presentation. As well as I've been able to build a recurring five-figure business around everything that I learned from doing launches as well as academies. And now I have a team of around 25 paying employees that I do pay on a regular basis to be able to build and expand this message onto more platforms and to more countries around the world. As well as I feel like every single week I'm being featured in like a new place and a new stands and like a new speaking event, which is super exciting. If you guys are interested in kind of following me on my journey, you can check out my Instagram and I showcase every single time I'm featured in a new event, which is super exciting because my formulas, my frameworks for learning have been adapted, and now they're kind of being very popularized on like Reddit, on YouTube now, and people are sharing them. So it's super great to see that these things that you're going to be learning in this presentation has had a now world impact. Now, the other kind of my big plans for 2021 kind of involved kind of taking my YouTube to the next level. I've posted a couple of videos here and there. So these are kind of like my videos from my YouTube channel. I wanted to do create a podcast, create an online event, a book, as well as actually have an MVP, like a beta app that I'm going to be launching at the end of this year. So if you guys are, like I said, are interested in following me in that journey, you could check out my Instagram or my YouTube channel. Now, like I said, I've been able to help people from, you know, starting from zero, whether you have the top marks, whether you have the worst marks in the world, be able to achieve results from high marks and be able to get that consistently over and over again, but also have a life, a work-life balance that is unmatched by any other individuals. So before we get started, I'd love to be able to know where you guys are from. I know a couple people are from Canada, a couple people from America. I saw some intros that are really amazing. So you have a chance, if you take a second right now, go to the chat and kind of comment where you guys are from. So I see that, Jersey, we have New York, Brooklyn. Megan says New York. Katie says I'm from the UK. Sophie, GTA, Canada, awesome. Boston, India, Philippines, India, yes, Indonesia, Connecticut, Texas. Okay, this is great. A lot of amazing places over here. And it's great to be able to see that, you know, this BEAMathon has, you know, has worldwide implications as well. And it's great to be able to see that this is, you know, reaching a huge, huge audience. This is kind of like the testimonials that I've been able to get from different companies as well as different places that I've been able to work for. But I wanted to show you guys that. And at the end of every presentation, I love giving a whole bunch of bonuses. And so at the end of this presentation, if you guys remind me, and I do have a slide at the end to kind of remind myself, I love giving my free ultimate study checklist as well as how to acquire language, because I was able to learn French in 30 days. So I actually go through that experience within a checklist is how to actually adapt what I was able to learn and apply it to your own language learning efforts. A little bit more about me, essentially that this idea that I always found that the harder you work, the greater success. That's what my parents always told me is something that we always hear in school. The more you work, the greater you'll get. You know, if you put 8 hours, you're gonna get 8 hours back. So I did exactly what they told me. It worked hard and hard. I studied for hours and hours on end. And although I didn't get good marks, I found I was getting completely burnt out. And until there was one thing that I realized that no one was talking about. You can't find this in books because it's this one idea about learning how to learn that completely changed everything that I did. I started learning some crazy things, some languages, to now starting to do some fitness challenges, as well as learning about the stock market and crypto, things that which I would never would have thought of actually learning about. And now I have this balance where I'm doing business, I'm still excelling in school, and have a lot of time to just be able to kind of relax, watch some TV, catch up on some of The Mandalorian and WandaVision, all that good stuff. So I'm able to still have that time to do those kind of things. And so in the next 45 minutes or so, I want to show you guys how to create the foundation for success, starting with the mindset and then adapting it to studying and learning, how to have this unlimited amount of motivation. Motivation and procrastination are the two biggest things that I see a lot of people kind of holding back on. And so I'm going to be showing you guys the secrets of how to have unlimited motivation, as well as the three different types of procrastination. And yes, there is more than one type of procrastination. And it's once you realize what type of procrastination that you are in, that you can actually manage it appropriately. As well as how to enter the state of maximum productivity, including the music that I listen to, the apps that I use, as well as the trackers that I add on to make sure I'm making the most of my time, as well as this idea that I call building a second brain from taking notes and ideas into actionable items for success. And of course, as Sky said, feel free to tag, you know, Beam Community. And if you want, you can also tag me on my personal Instagram account, especially if there's one slide that really resonates with you. I'll be able to share those on my story as well to kind of see the impact that I was able to have through this presentation. Now, this one idea I'm going to be talking about a lot is called accelerated learning, all right? So this might be an idea you might have heard of here and there, but I've been able to work with people to make sure they make the most of accelerated learning. So accelerated learning is this idea that most people learn at a linear rate, okay? Most individuals learn at a linear rate. But if you're able to take on this idea of accelerated learning, you could be at the very bottom of your class, you could be at the top of your class, and you'll be able to reach the top 1% of individuals because you are learning a lot faster than most individuals. Now, before I get started into the secrets, I want to give you three powerful tips, right? So wherever you are, take some notes. If possible, turn off your devices or put them on do not disturb. And number three, ask a lot of questions because asking questions, I'd love to be able to answer those questions, and I will be answering those questions at the end of this presentation. So these are the three powerful tips I often recommend. That 99% of people, unfortunately, learn like this. And if you're one of these individuals, give me like a thumbs up or a yes, right? So number one, you have ineffective learning techniques. You don't know how to study. You're studying for hours and hours on end. And because you study for hours on end, you get completely burnt out and you feel you have no time left in the day. And then when a test comes around, you're gonna, I wanna start doing the test. You have limited recall and you can't even remember what you actually learned. So then you do it again. You have ineffective learning techniques. You get burnt out and then the test comes around and you can't succeed because you can't remember what you learned, right? So if you can actually break these down individually, have a good learning techniques, then a master strategy so you don't get burnt out and have a powerful memory, then you don't have to go through this vicious cycle. So I see a couple people in the chat. Yeah, that's me. I don't like to study or studying does not work. Exactly. I'm getting called out right now. It's so funny. Yeah, that's great. Sounds familiar. Me, sounds like me. Exactly. So I totally agree that it's 99% of people, and this is very unfortunate. So I want to show with you this presentation is how to actually take this and actually flip it on its head by actually having effective learning techniques. But now before we get into the methods, I can give you the best methods in the world, but if you have a limiting belief on where you want to go, you're never going to get there, right? So I'm going to break three limiting beliefs that you might be having right now before I can even share with you the components within this presentation. Number one, I want you to stop saying I don't have time. All right. I want you to stop saying I don't have time. I want you to convert that to I'm choosing not to make time for this. This one act of just one mindset shift will make you realize that you have time to be able to do a lot of activities, but you're choosing to actually not do activities based on your preference. If you look a second right now, go to your settings and then even check how long you've been on social media. It's often 4 to 6 hours. And you say, I don't have time to do this. I don't have time to do that. Right. And so if you can actually take that mindset of I don't have time and then convert it over to I'm choosing not to make time for this, all right, that's going to completely change the way that you see time and the way that you approach activities and the way you approach opportunities coming your way. And number two, I want you to take on the 15-minute interval. Most people look at time in 30 minutes. They're like, it's 12, 12:30, 1 o'clock. That's most individuals. I want you to start looking at time as 15-minute intervals. And what does this do exactly? So instead of going on social media, let's say you have an event, you're doing a speaking event or whatever it may be, you have class at 1 o'clock and it's 12:30, or maybe it's 12:20, right? You're like, okay, for the next 30 minutes until it's 1 o'clock, until it's my school, I'm going to go on social media. And because you're looking at it as 30-minute intervals, you end up being on social media for 30 minutes. But if you were to flip that on its head and say that, from 3:30 to 3:45, that's when I'm going to be on social media. And from 3:45 to 4, that's when I'm going to prepare for school. So instead of looking at time as 30-minute intervals, I want you to take the mindset shift of actually looking at it as 15-minute intervals, which will actually decrease the amount of time you're wasting through social media or through different services that aren't providing you as much gain. And the third mind shift set I want you to change is this idea of motivation, right? So motivation, I'm going to be showing you guys how to hack motivation. And I want you to change motivation to thinking it's a myth, all right? Motivation is simply a myth because most people believe you have to do an action for motivation, but it's actually completely flipped on its head. In fact, it's the action that leads to success, right? So let's say you do a small action. Let's say you're not motivated to study. Let's say you're not motivated to study at all. So the way to actually, and you're like, I need motivation to study. That's not true. You don't need motivation to study. Simply, you need a small little win. You need a small little win. And those wins compound, right? So instead of saying, I don't have the motivation to study, I want you to instead say that I'm just going to open my textbook. I'm just going to read the first line in my textbook. And that in and of itself is a small win. If you want, you could put it down on a piece of paper. I'm going to open my textbook. And when you actually accomplish that right there, that is a check mark, right? That right there is the check mark. And that itself is your action. And from that action, that leads to success. And that success leads to motivation, right? So most people think they need motivation to complete the action. You need the action to complete the motivation, all right? So once you start looking at that as small wins rather than huge things you have to do. Instead of saying I have to study for 2 hours, say I have to open my textbook. And that is a lot more manageable. And that allows you to get the motivation to continue going forth in your activities. And like I said, you don't need motivation to get something done. When you get something done, you get motivated. I'm going to repeat that one more time for those people in the back audience. When you get something done, you become motivated. All right. So I want you to start looking at motivation like that. Now, number three, I want to quickly ask you guys a question. I love talking during these presentations. Which of the three mindsets do you want to change first? Do you want to change your motivation? Do you want to start looking at time in 15-minute intervals? Or do you, number one, I don't have time to, I'm choosing not to make time for this. Which of these mindsets do you want to change first? Motivation, yes, that's awesome. Sweet. Motivation for sure. Definitely in a 15-minute interval. Motivation, yes, exactly. Motivation is a strong one. And like I said, you got to change the way you look at motivation. Time, then motivation, 100%. A lot of motivation. I'm glad. Motivation is a huge one. But you know what's even bigger one? You know what's even bigger than motivation? It's procrastination. And so I'm going to be showing you guys quickly the three different types of procrastination. And once you recognize what type of procrastination and what type of procrastinator you are, then you can actually find ways to actually manage the procrastination appropriately. Number one is what I call phase one, the pusher, all right? This is my terms of actually naming them. And so phase one is called the pusher, right? So the pusher, and you know you're within the pusher, if you actually just need to have, and this is the solution here, this is the name of it, and this is the solution. So if you're the pusher, if you need to break it down to ridiculously small little tasks, right? So let's say you don't want to do something, but you just need a little push. That little push is just breaking it down into small, ridiculously small tasks. So for example, you don't want to study. I'm procrastinating, not studying. All you have to do just that little push, and then break it down into small little tasks. That's all you need. If you break it down to small little tasks, like I'm just going to open my textbook, then you're good to go. You can overcome procrastination. Now, the next level of procrastination is what I call the giver, right? And to be able to solve the giver, you need to ask yourself two different things. Number one, you need to ask yourself, why am I doing this activity? And most importantly, number two, you need to ask yourself, what happens if I don't do this activity, right? So let's say you have to study, let's say you have an exam tomorrow, you don't feel like studying. Even if you break it down into small little pieces, it's not enough motivation to keep you going. So you're gonna be moving over to phase two. And to be able to tackle phase two, you're gonna ask yourself, why am I doing this activity? And what happens if I don't do this activity? So let's say you have an exam tomorrow worth 50% of your mark. If I don't study, then I'm going to miss out on 50%, right? And I think, for example, if I don't work out, I'm going to be missing out on what I could become, right? So I want you to start thinking of yourself, especially in phase two, if you're that type of procrastinator, think of yourself as two different individuals, someone that you could have been and someone that you are right now. And so when you start doing an activity, you want to start looking like, I want to become that individual, right? I want you to start separating yourself as who you can become and who you are right now. And then for phase three, I often recommend putting a valuable item on the line. So if your procrastination level is the resistor, you start doing these two activities, you want to give an extra motivation, put a valuable item on the line. So for example, if you need to put money, if you need to start emitting on social media, I'm going to study. Simple as that. Post that. Give that self a little motivation. Have people, accountability partners are a huge part of that. Having a valuable item on the line. So for example, I really didn't want to do an essay. I just don't like doing essays. It's not my big thing. So I gave my brother $100. I told him, if I don't finish this essay by today, before this time, you got to keep the $100. And so you can imagine he was watching me like a hawk to make sure I got this activity done. Because if I didn't get it done, then he would actually take the money. So he made sure that I actually got it done, that we could have the money. So then I was able to finish it. And then I was able to take the money, the $100, and I was able to have it rather than giving it to my brother, right? So I had a valuable item on the line, which forced me to do that essay because I did not want to lose $100. So that's a bit of extreme, right? So most people don't go that far in the resistor. Most people are often either in a pusher or the giver. So that being said, what level of procrastination do you normally get at? When you don't feel like doing something, do you go as far as the resistor? Do you need to go as far as the resistor? Or are you more like the pusher or the giver? I'd love to be able to know a little bit about that. The resistor. Awesome. Oh, really? The resistor, Selena. Okay. That's awesome. Okay. At least now you know how to tackle it. The giver. Awesome. Yeah. I pride myself as not to be a procrastinator. I do things as I get them. That's awesome, Raven. That's great. Pusher, phase two, resistor, pusher, resistor. Awesome. So people are resistors and that's 100% okay. But now you know all of them. That's funny. So now you know how to actually tackle each and every one of them. Now that you know that there's different phases and then you can actually tackle them appropriately. And the other big thing that I often get, so it's often motivation that people have trouble with, and then it's procrastination that people have trouble with. And the third part of that is burnout, right? So people study for hours and hours on end and they get completely burnt out. And so I want you to take the 3R approach, right? This is developed by my friend Josephine, who actually works with me within my academy. So she developed this 3R approach, which is absolutely genius, all right? So it's recognize, reverse, and then resilience, right? So recognize, you want to recognize, first of all, that you are in burnout, right? For me, when I get burnt out, I have this weird like sort of sensation in my stomach. I just don't like it. So that's my warning sign. For other individuals, it might be something else. It might be, like a little bit of an ache or whatever it may be. It's either a physical, emotional, or behavioral signs that shows that you are, starting to get burnt out. So you want to recognize, number one, that you are burnt out, right? And number two, you want to start undoing the damage by seeking support. So how do I do this in particular? I actually have a sticky note on my desk every single time. So I've actually have two sticky notes, but one of the sticky notes that I do have actually dictates different steps that I need to do right away if I ever get burnt out. Number one is that I text a friend or I call a friend. Number two, if that doesn't work, then I listen to just one of my favorite songs. I have a playlist on Spotify that I absolutely love. It gets me in the mood, it gets me going. So that completely changes the person that I am. So I have those two steps. And number three, I have another step. Number four, I have another step. So I have this different list of steps that I need to do. So number three, I have to work out. Number four, I just need to do some sort of meditation. So now I recognize, number one, that I am burnt out. And number two, I have a system to make sure that I'm able to reverse my burnout appropriately. And number three is resilience, right? So you want to be able to build your resilience to stress by taking care of your physical and emotional health, by using these two activities and actually having that system. Like I said, for me, it's the sticky notes. For you, it might be a reminder on your phone. It might be an alarm. It might be a text message from your friend every once in a while. Whatever it may be, develop a system so that when you do get burnt out, and you will get burnt out, it's inevitable, you actually have a system to be able to make sure you're going to be able to take that appropriately. And for those sort of organizational freaks, especially, I'm definitely one of them. The other system that I often develop is called the PAIR method. And so anything you think about in life, all the websites, all the clips you can take care of, all the YouTube videos, all the social media posts, everything that you can think of, all right, can be broken down into four main areas. And this is how you organize your life, this is how you organize your life through the different apps you use, through the websites and the bookmarks you do. And this is called the PARA method. And everything you do can be broken down into this method, all right? So let's say you have a sort of, so you have a language test you have to complete. So first of all, the PARA method stands for project, areas, resources, and archive, right? And like I said, everything you can think of falls into one of these areas. You could see even in my Google Drive, I only have four folders in my Google Drive. And then from then, it goes into different folders that are more organized. But everything in my life, everything in your life can be broken down into four main folders. Number one is projects, right? So this includes business projects. This includes your language test. If you're going to complete a course in school, this is where you're going to keep that school folder within that projects. So these ones have deadlines, right? You have a deadline for your language test. You have a deadline for your business project you have to complete. This is going to be your most active folder that you're going to be using. Now, the areas have no deadlines, right? So the areas of your life are the overarching big points of your life. So for example, I want to get into real estate when I'm a little bit older. And right now I'm also into language learning. So language learning is my big area, right? So language learning is my big area. And then underneath that, I have projects. I'm going to be showing you that, what that looks like in just a second. And then I have another area for resources. This is my screenshots. This is my wallpapers that I use, right? And number four, I have an archive system. I have this area where I don't use it anymore. These are often projects that are done. These are old high school notes I don't use. But as you can see, everything you could think of, a website that I want to look into later on, that's a resource, an area I want to start going into, a new area that I'm going to be like, I want to try out. Say you want to start going into crypto or stocks. That's an area of your life. Area, boom. Everything you could think about can be broken down into this PARA method. There's nothing that can get out of this resource area. But it's really powerful once I'm going to be showing you guys the next slide. This is where you're going to be able to see all of these ideas connect. So your area, for example, is your language learning. That's your area. Your project may be your language learning test. Your resources include the websites, includes the clips, it includes the social media posts that are inspirational. It includes the TikToks that kind of motivates you to continue language learning. That's your resources, right? And then underneath your projects, what do you have? You have your tasks and you have your purpose, right? So when you're doing a project, let's say, I keep using language learning as an example, but let's keep going on with that. So let's say we're going to be doing a language learning like test. Then I have my tasks that I need to do. I need to research this. I need to research that. I'm going to watch this video. I'm going to do this resource. That's my tasks. But most importantly, you have your purpose. Why are you learning inspiration? Why are you doing, why are you learning French? Why are you learning Spanish, right? So then you have your purpose based on those projects. And finally, you have the ideas and inspiration here. I just didn't want to write the whole word inspiration. So the resources are all your ideas. So if you have an interesting idea, let's say, oh, I want to start learning German. Where do you put that, right? You put that inside your resources. And over time, your resources get so built up that you're going to be able to have a system that you can actually periodically review your resources. And then you've got to be able to see your ideas as well as your inspiration based on your resources, right? So inspiration, let's say you're going to be able to make an Instagram post. You need to be able to save all the posts on your Instagram that you actually enjoy. That way, when you actually start doing your project, you're already ahead of the game in terms of what you're going to make. Most people, they start off the project. Okay, I'm going to make an Instagram post. I'm going to take this photo. And then they're like, what do I do now? They need the resources. And so if you have a huge amount of resources, any project you pursue becomes so easy to do. And of course, you have the archive for projects that are end up becoming useless. And so how do I actually do this on Google Drive? And how do I do this on Notion? So on Google Drive, like I said, I go from projects, and the two main projects that I'm a part of right now is my company, as well as my academy. Then I go into areas. What are my areas in my life right now? That's business. That's online persona, personal branding. That's language learning, right? How do I do this on Notion? And so I see a lot of people love this Notion thing. Honestly, I love it myself too. So how do I do this on Notion? I have different databases. So I have my areas database, my learning, health and fitness, content creation, product, productivity, creativity, personal branding. These are my areas that correspond to my areas with Google Drive. Then I have my projects that relate to my areas. And then inside my projects, I have my actions and my purpose, right? Do you see how everything kind of connects and nothing gets out of the loop? So when people, they don't know where to go or what things they want to pursue, all they have to do, if I'm bored, I look through my ideas list. Then I make a project out of the ideas list and I get motivated to start doing an interesting activity. So a quick little recall test for you guys here. What does para stand for? If you could kind of name me what P stands for. I see a lot of Notion fans over here. That's awesome. Projects, awesome projects. Perfect, perfect. What is A? What does the first A stand for? What is the overarching area? You guys are killer. Oh my gosh. Okay, chill. What does the resources stand for? Oh, damn it. Okay, sorry. That's on me. What does the last A stand for? Archive. Yes. Okay, awesome. So everything in your life can be broken down into those four main areas. So for example, if I were to say, make a website, is that an area or is that a project, right? What is the difference between area and projects? You guys remember? Project has a what? Project, yes, website is a project because projects have deadlines, right? Deadlines, you guys are amazing. You guys are absolutely amazing. You guys are killer. Okay, that's awesome. Projects has tasks, projects have deadlines, perfect. Yes, that's awesome. So because projects has a deadline and because your website eventually needs to have a deadline, you're going to put that inside that project. So the area for that could be personal branding. That can be coding, right? That's your area. Underneath that is your projects that you're going to be having, all right? Awesome. So let's talk a little bit about the state of maximum productivity. But before we get there, give me like a little thumbs up if you guys are enjoying this so far. If you're getting some value out of this, if you're learning about a new framework, give me a little thumbs up either in the chat or like in the little reactions, I guess you can do as well. Okay, awesome. We got a couple of thumbs up. Very informative. Great stuff. Okay, perfect, perfect. So let's get into the state of maximum productivity. Okay, so first of all, I want to talk a little bit about multitasking. That's a huge thing. So should you or should you not multitask? And my rule is if you're doing light activities, then you can have the option of multitasking. If you're doing heavy lifting, then you should not be doing multitasking. So what does light activities kind of look like? So because I love making the most out of my learning, if I'm washing my dishes, if I'm, you know, cleaning the floor, cleaning my room, whatever it may be, that's a light activity. I can listen to some music, all right? That's all 100% okay. Because this sort of multitasking is 100% okay. But if I'm doing heavy lifting, if I'm doing homework, if I'm calling a friend, then I cannot be doing my homework. I cannot be calling a friend, doing my homework, and then listening to an audiobook. That's not possible, right? That's when it becomes super, super ineffective, right? However, for should, if I'm doing the dishes, then I can be multitasking. As for digital workflow, I see a lot of Notion fans, but the way I'm a huge digital guy, right? So if anyone who knows me, they know I'm a huge digital individual. And so I want you to imagine, because the world is going so much into digital systems, why not fall into that digital system? A lot of people are paper individuals, and that is great. But if you start taking the route into a digital system, that's when you start taking your life into the next level. So let me show you a little bit about my system, right? So sometimes I write my notes, especially if I'm gonna be really nice on the Apple Notes, the Notability Good Notes. Then I have my Todoist systems. Then I have my projects, my areas on Notion. That's my life operating system. And then for all the different tasks that I have on a day-to-day basis, that's my Google Calendar, right? So instead of relying on paper, so for example, if you were to have a paper calendar, imagine you're like, okay, I have a meeting with Sky at this time at 1 to 2, right? So me and Sky are gonna have a meeting at 1 to 2. And I'm like, no, I can't, I'm busy during that time. So then I have to erase it from my calendar on paper, then move it to the next meeting. And then she's like, no, I can't do it that time. I have to erase it, then move it again. Same thing with tasks. If you're writing tasks on paper, then you're like, okay, I'm gonna do these three things today. Something comes up, you can only do two of them. You have to erase that task again, move it over to the next one. With Todoist, with Notion, it's literally drag and drop. It's drag and drop, guys. Same thing with Google Calendar. All you have to do is drag and drop that to the next area. That's all it is. It takes 2 seconds, and those 2 seconds adds up. So then when you're actually converting into digital note-taking systems, it is honestly a no-brainer to be able to save a lot of time. I do want to talk a little bit about aesthetic versus learning, all right? So obviously I have this very aesthetic node right here. And so I do want to let you guys know about that, all right? So one of the biggest problems that I see is that a lot of people in terms of studying are rewriting their notes. That is the most ineffective way to learn. Actually, sorry, that's like the second most ineffective way. There's actually a worse way to actually learn. But rewriting your notes does not work as well. And I'm going to be showing you guys how to actually make your effective note-taking systems a lot better. But rewriting your notes is one of the most effective, ineffective ways because number one, you feel you have this boost of confidence that's not realistic because you're rewriting your notes. And then you're like, I understand this material, but you don't actually understand it. You're just rewriting it. You're just regurgitating it. There's no new information added. There's no new insights added. And so when you're rewriting your notes, you feel like, okay, I understand this material, but you actually don't. You're just copying something that's over and over again. It's like watching the same movie over and over again. And just like, oh, I love this movie. Yeah, it's a great movie, but you're not getting anything from it the second time you're watching it, right? So when you're rewriting your plans, that's also ineffective. And like I said, Google Calendar with Todoist, you're gonna able to have a system that actually works for you instead of against you. So when instead of rewriting your plans over and over again, I'm gonna change this calendar, I'm gonna move this over here. Instead of that, you actually have a system through digital note-taking systems that you can actually make it super easy to actually drag and drop systems. And number three, you're gonna rewrite your appointments and tasks kind of goes well hand in hand with planning. In terms of effective note-taking, the main secret of effective note-taking comes down to active recall and spaced repetition, which I cannot discuss in this presentation because I'm kind of tight on time, especially different topics I'm going to be talking about later on. But essentially, the idea is that when you're actually studying, you want to make sure, number one, is that you're actually actively testing yourself. So this is where Quizlet comes in. This is where another application comes in later on. I'm going to be showing you guys that how I actually use that in just a second. And number two, the only time you should be rewriting stuff is writing your goals over again. And because when you actually write your goals over again, that's where you're going to be able to actually memorize those activities. I'm going to be showing you why writing your goals is actually effective. And number three is actually setting reoccurring appointments and tasks through Google Calendar. Imagine you have an appointment every single day. Let's say every single week on Wednesday for like a chiropractor. So every single Wednesday on your calendar, on paper, you're going to have to write that every single Wednesday for the rest of your life. Yeah, that's very ineffective. That's very ineffective. Instead, you want to actually have an effective system where you actually have Google Calendar set recurring intervals, and then you don't even have to worry about it anymore, right? So you want to make sure that all this stress you're having, sometimes that comes down to just having paper systems that are ineffective. So this is why I'm a huge advocate for like digital note-taking systems, which is why I'm kind of leaning towards that a little bit more. Now, there's just one thing I want you to take away from this presentation. It's this learning pyramid, right? This learning pyramid dictates everything that you do, right? So this is the one thing I want you to take away from this presentation, right? That at the end of the day, you're only going to remember 5% of the lecture that you're going to be doing. So out of this workshop, unfortunately, just the way our brain works, you're only going to remember 5% of this, which is really unfortunate. But if you start doing the three bottom activities, I see a lot of like discussion. I can't read all of them and also talk, but I'm loving the discussion about mango so far, guys. But if you're going to be able to continue talking and discussing while we're doing this, that's when you actually make the most out of this conversation because you're building connections, you're building emotion. The other part is actually practicing. If you, you know, just take the idea of the three different types of procrastination, like I showed you guys, but then you never take action on them, it also becomes useless. You want to make sure you're obviously practicing the activities I'm teaching you guys. And number three, I want you guys to teach this to someone else. It's when you actually teach the activity to someone else that you actually learn it a lot quicker than everyone else, right? This is why like the smartest kids always become the smartest kids, because right when a whole new question is about to start, right when like a difficult idea, you always go to the smart kids, right? And then the smart kids explain the topic to you guys, and that just only makes the smart kids even more smarter, right? That's insane. You're literally fueling the smart guys. Like come on, guys, come on. So when you actually start doing these activities, you want to make sure you're actually teaching these to other individuals. This is why the smart guys always become smarter, because they're always teaching, because you never want to ask the teacher, right? Because it's kind of like, I don't know, you just don't want to ask them. So you always go to the smart guys, which is kind of unfortunate. Now, the truth about writing by hand, all right, like I said, I'm a big digital note-taking guy. So the truth about writing by hand is that the myth is that writing by hand helps you remember. All right. This is a huge myth that I see out there, that writing by hand helps me remember. And although it does have some credibility, I actually want to show you guys the truth. And the truth is that writing by hand only helps in short-term retention. All right. Writing by hand only helps in short-term retention. So for example, let's say you have your first lesson in class, which is in September, and you have your exam in December. And if you say, I'm going to write by hand because that helps me remember, then you're actually totally missing out on a whole different point, because yes, you're going to help you remember maybe for the test, but for the exam, you're definitely not going to remember that material just by writing it by hand, which is why the next step into digital note-taking systems is actually writing it down and actually typing the material out. And I'm going to be showing you guys how I actually type the material using a different application to make sure that it actually uses the systems appropriately. So for example, if Notion, you can never do like a Notion system on paper. You have to do it through digital systems, which only makes sense. So when should you actually use paper? You should use it when setting short-term goals, which only makes sense because short-term goals are short-term retention and they're only relevant for a short period of time before you make new goals. That's so you should be able to set goals. I actually rewrite my goals every single morning. And number two, you want to be able to reduce the aesthetics. So for example, sometimes digital note-taking systems can be super elegant with all the different colors you can play around with. And if you do want like a sort of a simplistic design, then I do recommend taking notes by paper. And number three is late idea making. So for example, if I'm out, maybe I'm like at a friend's house and I forgot to bring my phone. And so what I often do is I have a little piece of paper that I just ask them to borrow and actually write down my ideas on that piece of paper. And then later on, I'll convert that into a digital note-taking system. If I don't have a digital note-taking system with me, on me, my phone, whatever it may be, but often I do. So this often doesn't become a problem. And then I also want to talk to you guys around productivity about the $10 rule, all right? So this is like the third most important thing I actually want you guys to get out of this presentation is the $10 rule. So most people, when they study, when they learn, when they're doing different activities, they're like, I just studied for 3 hours. Mom, I studied for 4 hours. I studied for 8 hours. That's great. But when you're studying, you're often just doing $10 activities, right? So if you're highlighting your notes, if you're rereading your notes in effective study techniques, you're just doing $10 activities. And so even though you can get maybe $80 theoretically at the end of those 8 hours, you're totally missing out on the best sort of studying, which is active recall, spaced repetition, and interleaving. These are the fundamentals of study. This is how you study appropriately. And so that same person who studies 8 hours, but is only doing $10 activities versus the person who's doing 8 hours and doing $1,000 activities, that's the person that's actually, you know, studying appropriately. So you can actually make this a lot better. You can study for maybe 1 or 2 hours, get $2,000 worth of studying, rather than taking 20 hours or even 20 plus hours and just get maybe only $200 of studying, right? So we'll just start looking at this in terms of like money-wise, that when you're studying, you want to study appropriately and effectively. Now, the second most important thing I want you guys to take away from this is the flow state. So the flow state is a state of maximum productivity, right? The flow state is a state of maximum productivity. So most individuals, like I said, they study for a certain amount of hours and then you only do $10 activities, giving them only 4 hours or like maybe $40 worth of activities. But it's those individuals that are at the top of the class that actually know and actually manipulate the flow state to make it work for them. And so at the top of the class, they enter the state of flow, which is the state of maximum productivity. They go past the priming. So priming is making sure you have no distractions, no social media. The second you have a notification on your phone, you go back to the beginning, right? So for example, let's say you're doing 29 minutes of good studying. You get a notification on your phone, you go back to the beginning. So you want to make sure when you're studying and when you're getting deep into your work, this is called deep work, that you have no distractions. And over time, you're going to be able to see 2 times, even 3 times the amount of productivity during that same period. So those individuals who understand this idea are able to make the most out of it because they're actually entering the state of flow, not having any distractions, and then leaving out 7.5 hours plus of the amount of work they're going to be doing rather than the most individuals who are just 4 hours of work. And of course, I want to be showing you guys a couple of the productivity apps. You guys love Notion, but I can guarantee you guys that there's a couple other apps I'm going to be sharing with you guys in just a second that you're going to love even more, all right? Is that even possible? Can you love Notion like even less than some of these apps? Well, we're going to see that in just a second. So number one is called RemNote. So RemNote is this new revolutionary app that's right in the market. So if you guys are hopping on this application right now, you're going to be ahead of the game in terms of everyone else. And this actually adds on this activity of active recall and spaced repetition. The way it works is that it uses Quizlet. It combines Quizlet plus Notion plus this other app that's really cool that you might have not heard of before called Anki, combines them all together into a seamless note-taking application in which the second you write notes, so let's say I wrote notes about the forgetting curve, it automatically converts the notes you take into test-taking material. So all the notes you normally take on paper, if you were to convert this into RemNote using AI systems, it automatically creates testing and automatically creates testing recall for you to use, right? So this is the best way to be able to learn. And like I said, memorize, organize what you learn. This is Notion plus Anki plus the different apps combined together. How can you not love this, right? But I still use Notion. RemNote's only good if you want to actually memorize the material. I only use it for school and for big activities that I have trouble actually memorizing, like different terms in the stock market that are kind of difficult to understand. That's when I actually use RemNote because that helps me with memorization. And they also recently released an app that they have no apps on like your phone. If people are wondering, it's just a website that people can go to. It's the top studying application out there, and it's just fresh out of the market. I think got released maybe April 2020. So if you hop on this right now, I can guarantee you, you're gonna see a lot of results. It is a bit of a learning curve to actually understand, but the amount of time you put in is the amount of time you're gonna get out times two. As for those individuals, I did notice a question before asking about what is the best type of music to actually listen to. So most people listen to Spotify music, most people listen to other music. These two websites are the best, and they actually do have phone applications. These two websites are the best in terms of actually getting you into the focus state, right? So the first one's called brain.fm. It's actually a website. It's actually a little hack to actually make it free. If you guys are interested, you could DM me on Instagram. I could get you like a free version because actually like it's paid. But like there's a little hack that you could find. You have to go through like different YouTube portals to be able to find it. And you can get the application for free, even though it is a paid service. And the second one's called Endo. And oh my gosh, guys, this has one of the best and sort of like music. It's just so great because you listen to headphones, like the whole world around you, you just want to work. It's amazing. So this is a new application that's kind of beating brain.fm, but I do switch between them every once in a while as well. And then KaiWake. So for those individuals that have trouble waking up in the morning, that used to be me. I now use this application called KaiWake, which automatically, when you actually, I guess like when you wake up, instead of having a normal alarm, it actually makes you start doing activities, which means like doing a math problem, doing a puzzle. And so when I wake up, I have to do these activities before I can even click snooze, which actually forces me to actually wake up. This is a must application, and you can download this on your phone. It's actually not a website that I know of. Maybe it is, but I do use it on my phone instead of the alarm. As for the Chrome extensions that I recommend, and Chrome extensions are huge. Number one, I recommend this one Chrome extension called Video Speed Controller. So most people watch YouTube videos, most people watch lectures at one time speed. Imagine if you could watch lectures at 1.5. Two, and the maximum that YouTube actually allows you to actually watch a video is 2x speed. Now, this allows you to take whatever platform, YouTube, Instagram, whatever it may be, allow you to actually speed the video up faster, because most of the material is a lot of fluff. Just like in books, you have this huge book, 80% of that is fluff, 20%, really, if the author really wanted to, they could have like squeezed that book into like maybe like 40 pages, and you still would have got the same amount of material because of it. It's the same way in most YouTube videos that are educational, most lectures even, the biggest meat of the lecture really comes down to just a few different points. And so with this video speed controller, you're going to be able to go past the limit that YouTube sets as 2x and go like 2.1, 2.2. And you can even rewind a lot quicker. So for example, instead of having to go and like click this little button to rewind or click this one again, it actually, you really have keyboard shortcuts that allows you to go back and back really, really quickly, allowing you to go through lectures at 2x, 3x, even 4x the amount of speed that you normally would be going to. Then as for most people do have Notion, but most people don't even know about Save to Notion, which is actually an amazing application, which is actually better than the Notion built-in application. Is actually a third-party application. So for example, if I have a resource that I want to look into afterwards, remember R in the para method is a resource. If I have a website that I just really love, then what I do, I click Save to Notion. I have this Chrome extension that automatically saves this one website into my Notion workflow, which means I don't have to copy then paste. I could be going through a whole bunch of different blogs, click Save to Notion, another button, and that's it. I know it's within my database. I know it's within what I call my second brain. I don't even have to worry about it anymore. And the same thing with Todoist, you do have an option as well to automatically add tasks without even being on the application. You can get a Todoist Chrome extension that allows you to do that so quickly. The other thing a lot of people have questions about is having the best iPhone setup. And so a lot of people have the mistake of actually having their Instagram, having their social medias on their first page on their phone. So for example, if I were to go to like my social medias, you actually have to go like, you have to swipe. You have to like, okay, I don't know if you guys can see that. Where's my camera? You have to actually swipe then you have to tap on the folder, swipe again, and then tap on Instagram. Well, most individuals have like Instagram at the bottom, which actually encourages them to actually go on social media. So if you actually increase the amount of resistance to be able to do an activity, the less you're going to be able to do it, right, guys? So you want to make sure that you actually have these social medias inside a folder, then you have to swipe in that folder to be able to see that, and actually go deep and deep into like the settings and actually how to optimize settings. So for example, there's even like deeper stuff, you can go into that. That's the basic one. And there's a YouTube channel video on my YouTube channel if you guys are interested about that. So that's pretty much the presentation. You guys learned about the foundations of success, starting with the mindset. You guys learned about the three different mindset shifts you need to change, how to adapt your studying and your learning to be able to make the most out of it, how to have the unlimited amount of motivation. Remember my motivation hack, as well as the three different types of procrastination. You guys kind of saw a sneak peek of my building a second brain through my digital systems, as well as entering a state of maximum productivity through music, apps, and trackers. If you have any questions, feel free to let me know. But before we actually finish off here, I love giving a quick learning challenge to everyone that watches the presentation. I give learning challenges to every presentation that I go to, every webinar that I'm a part of, every conference that I'm asked to speak at. It's just one simple learning challenge, okay? So this learning challenge is direct message me on Instagram and share something valuable that you learned, all right? So like I said, going back to the learning pyramid, you remember 90% of what you share, right? So even if you share to your friend, share to someone else, DM me when you have a chance and share the one thing that you're going to take action on, right? I want to be holding you accountable. I remember this one guy in my presentation back in like December or November. He's like, Matthew, I loved your three types of procrastination. I'm going to be using number two. I'm like, okay, I'm going to hold you against it. All right. I'm going to hold you against it. So then every once in a while I do message him. I'm like, hey, are you still procrastinating? He's like, ever since I've been using your methods, I have never been procrastinating. In fact, now I'm learning a new language. Now I'm doing this. Now I'm doing that because of your methods. So when you have a chance, DM me, share something that's actionable. All right. Share the biggest takeaway you got from this, right? The biggest takeaway, whether it's the notion systems, whether it's the types of procrastination, the motivational hacks, right? I shared it to you guys, a lot of different methods, but really just the tip of the iceberg of what I often show through my YouTube channel and whatnot. But I did want to share with you guys kind of the big ideas. So hopefully you guys kind of got some knowledge from that. And a lot of people also ask me like, where can I follow you? Like, you're a pretty cool guy. Where can I follow you? Right. So often I recommend my newsletter, and in my newsletter, I talk about every single week, I share an email talking about the principles of building my business, productivity, and learning. So if I learn about a new application, if I learn about a new website, you are going to be the first person to know about this, right? I'm consuming information faster than most individuals. And so if you actually sign up through my newsletter every single Sunday, so even tonight, you're going to a little snippet about all the different applications that I learned about. You're going to be able to know all the tools that I'm a part of. You're going to be able to see all the different clubs, all the different conferences. They're going to be doing. And this is my main hub that I just send you guys valuable packed emails. It's going to be the one email you're going to be opening every single week. I can guarantee you that. I've got a lot of replies for that. This is my top stuff that I share. Everything that I learned goes into this single email. And I do have an academy as well that kind of goes into these topics and then more. And so I open my academy up every three times per year. So I just finished it up just January. I got some amazing testimonials from that, which is why I'm kind of speaking in different places nowadays. And now we open back again during the summer because I don't want to open up like during exams or during school. And so then you can actually check out tinyurl.com/al-waitlist. And then you're going to be able to actually sign up. Actually, I can probably copy that. Maybe I can't. Okay. You're going to be able to sign up for the waitlist when it opens back up in the summer. You're going to be able to know all about those details then. And like, again, going back to the learning challenge, feel free to DM me. I want to hold you accountable to your goals. I love being able to see the results you guys got from the platform, from what I was able to teach you guys. And I'll pass it over to Sky here. Let me just stop sharing if we can figure out how to do this here. Okay, there we go. Stop sharing.
Yeah,
awesome.
Perfect. Thank you so much for that amazing presentation. There's some people in the chat who are asking if they can have like the sure. direct link or
subscribe
to their YouTube channel, or if there's like some sort of link that they can see like all of your things, like your newsletter and stuff like that.
So yeah, for sure. I'll definitely send it on the way.
Yeah. And I guess we can have maybe like 2 to 3 minutes for questions, and then we can announce the social media winner and do some fun pictures and stuff like that. So does anyone have any questions related to the presentation besides the links and stuff like that? I think I saw some questions up in the chat, but it was pretty far up there. Let me check. Let's see. So everyone here likes Notion, right? Or is anyone going to use any of the platforms that he suggested and stuff? Yes, we love it. Yeah, I saw some people taking notes. It's really awesome. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, I love everyone's using the Oh, someone said, do you have any tips for reading and retaining information?
Yeah, so I actually have a different method for that as well. It's called the SAT method. So the SAT method goes share. So when you actually memorize something, you're trying to memorize something, like I said, the best way to actually memorize it, the best way to learn it is by sharing it to someone else, right? And so when you learn something new, when you're reading a book, whether it's a textbook, whether it's a statistic online, by sharing it, you're going to be able to memorize it a lot more effectively. So that goes well with the retention that you're asking about. And then the A is action. So I read a lot of self-development books about business, about stocks, all that interesting stuff, maybe not that interesting for you guys. So the A is action. How can I take action from what I learned, from what I read? And number T is, when am I actually going to take action, right? So a lot of people are like, I'm going to work out tomorrow, I'm going to do this tomorrow. And then they never put it in their calendar, and it never gets done, right? It never gets done. So the SAT, share, action, and timing allows you to retain information as quickly as possible. Great question, Victory.
Yeah, awesome. Thank you so much for the tips. Another question that is pretty popular is, how do you go about learning a new language?
Yeah, so through my language learning efforts, I was able to learn language French in 30 days, as well as get my certificate. So learning a language, I actually recommend watching my YouTube video on the topic. I'll type in the YouTube channel if you guys are interested. And it's like my most popular video. I think it's almost at 7K now. And just talks about how I was able to learn a language in 30 days. I don't want to go too deep into it because I think I explained a lot better in my video. But I do use a formula called MIND. So I use motivation, input, narrow, and diverge. And I guess I explained a lot better in the presentation. Oh, I did forget to send it. That's a great question as well.
Awesome. Maybe we can have one more question. Yeah, feel free to subscribe to Brain Companion and follow Matthew on Instagram, and you can see all of his like links and stuff like that. Someone asked, do you have any tips for improving your attention span?
Yeah, so attention span is a huge one as well. I think it kind of goes well with like memory and motivation. Attention span, I would say, would just be taking enough breaks. So the thing with breaks that people underestimate, they're like, I'm going to study for 8 hours a day. That's very ineffective because you need those breaks. So those breaks allow you to not only not get burnt out, but number two, the biggest thing of breaks is based on this idea of hook methodology. So hook methodology is this idea that you remember the first thing that you study, that you learn, and the last thing that you study. So most people, they study for 8 hours, but they might only remember hour number one and hour number eight. They completely forgot about hour number two to hour number seven. So by having more breaks, you end up having a lot more areas and less areas in between that you're going to be able to forget. So if you have even like 25 minutes of studying, then a break for 5 minutes, like using a Pomodoro method, right? This allows you to actually use and take advantage of the hook methodology, which, like I said, you just remember the beginning and you remember the ending. And those are the biggest things, especially for kind of making sure you're pretty good in that area.
Yeah, awesome. Thank you so much for answering all those questions and that amazing presentation. Unfortunately, we just have to move on to a few things like taking a picture and the social media competition winners. But feel free to contact him on Instagram. Of course, as he said, just talk to him about one thing that you learned from the amazing presentation. And yeah, stay in touch. So few things. One, we're going to take a cute picture. So if you guys want to turn on your camera, see those amazing faces, get hyped. Come on, let's go, guys. Y'all want prizes? All right. All right, come on, a few more people pull through. We need a full screen. We're so close. Oh my God, yes. Brave soldiers. Yes. I really do not have an idea for like another pose, because my go-to pose is like very basic. It's like the peace sign. So I don't know if y'all have any other ideas. Come on, we need some more faces. Look, there's 41 people. I'm gonna keep track of the people who are most active in front of the cameras and give them prizes. Come on, guys. Yes, look at y'all. Yes. Oh, love those backgrounds. All right, let's see. More people? Nah? Okay. You know what? Okay, we'll go with this. So is there any pose that you guys have, like any other ideas? Because I literally ran out. Isn't that the BTS heart? What do I call it? Or is it K-pop heart? I don't know what it is.
It's the K-pop heart, but BTS fans use this too.
Oh, okay. Sure, let's do the K-pop part, guys. All right, ready? 3, 2, 1. Hey, okay, let's do, is there another basic pose besides peace signs and hearts? I guess we're just gonna do a double peace sign. Let's be basic again. All right. Ready? And 3, 2, 1. Why is my camera not working? Okay, perfect. So now I'm just gonna do this like cute little video thing that we'll post on Instagram and we'll tag Ring Companion as well. So I'm just gonna put on a little bit of music, and when I say to wave and stuff, you're just gonna wave your hands. So give me a second. What haven't we done? I did like Nicki Minaj. Let's see. Why don't we just do Last Friday Night? Cause I think I did that at the beginning. So, okay. Tell you guys to wave in a bit, 1 second, when the beat drops. Wave, hey! Love this workshop. Thanks for coming, everyone. Oh my God, be fun, day two. Okay. Alrighty, so before we wrap up and go into the next workshop, we're going to announce the social media competition winners. Okay. Oh wait, actually, I think there's only one, but let me just share the screen. So can we get a drum roll, please? I hope it's just not me. Please. No, it's dead crickets. Okay, fine. I'll go. 3, 2, 1, and congratulations, Emily, for winning some Beam stickers. I'll contact you after the Beamathon for your mailing address. And don't worry, there's going to be so many more opportunities to win prizes in all the other workshops. So let me just share my screen again and just do a little outro. Alrighty, so thank you so much for coming to this workshop. Thank you, Matthew, for presenting. And I'll see you later in your next workshops. Bye. Always say remember.